Hello, Vital Sign. Today we're going to look at an intro to sine graph colorings. There are a few approaches to this concept, but for today we'll use Zaslavsky's approach. To recap, a sine graph G sigma is a graph whose edges have a positive or negative sign. It consists of an unsigned graph G together with a function sigma that labels each edge with a positive or negative sign. Also, when we talk about a graph coloring, technically a proper coloring, we sometimes talk about assigning actual colors to the vertices, like red or green. But let's consider the more general idea of a graph coloring, which is an assignment of labels to vertices, such that adjacent vertices are assigned different labels, and where the labels are taken from the set of positive integers. In graph theory, a k-coloring is defined to be a coloring where the labels are taken from the set of positive integers less than or equal to a positive integer k. The chromatic number of a graph is the smallest k such that a k-coloring exists. Now let's look at sine graphs. In a coloring of a sine graph, the rules are a little different. For one, the labels are taken from the integers. That means including all the negative integers and zero. If we label without using zero, we have what is known as a zero-free coloring. And since we can label with negative or positive integers here, we can say that we use signed colors to color a signed graph. Now, as with colorings of unsigned graphs, we have a restriction on what colors we can assign to adjacent pairs of vertices in a signed graph. Let U and V be adjacent vertices. Let C be our coloring function that labels vertices with integers. Let E be the edge that links U and V. And let S be the function that assigns positive 1 to positive edges and negative 1 to negative edges in our signed graph. Then C of V must be distinct from S of E times C of U. Intuitively, this single rule really means two things. If the edge linking adjacent vertices is positive, those vertices must be labeled with distinct integers. While if the edge linking adjacent vertices is negative, those vertices must be labeled with integers that are not additive inverses of each other. For example, if these two vertices were linked by a negative edge in some sine graph, we could not assign 5 to one vertex and negative 5 to the other vertex. But we could assign 5 to both of them, something that would be prohibited if they were linked by a positive edge. Also, note that if they were linked by a positive edge, assigning 5 to one and negative 5 to the other would be fine. But we would not be able to assign 5 to both. Here is a side-by-side comparison of an improper coloring, that is, one that violates our rules, and a proper coloring of a sine graph. Note that in the improper coloring, we have a positive edge linking vertices with the same color, and a negative edge linking vertices of additive inverse colors, both not allowed. Moving on, a k-coloring of a sine graph is a coloring where the labels are taken from the set of all integers whose magnitude is less than or equal to k. This is really a set of 2k plus 1 labels. A zero-free k-coloring is taken from the same set except with 0 excluded, which is really a set of 2k labels. The chromatic number of a sine graph is the smallest positive integer k such that there exists a k coloring, and the strict chromatic number is the smallest positive integer k such that there exists a zero free k coloring. To demonstrate, here's a sine graph with a 2 coloring. Its colors are taken from the set negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, 2. And here is the same sine graph with the zero-free 2 coloring. Note that we don't have to use all the colors in our set for it to be a 2 coloring. As long as the labels are taken from the set of integers whose magnitude is at most 2, it's still a 2 coloring. Interestingly, in a sine graph, the set of vertices colored with some non-zero integer n is not necessarily an independent set, as it must be in an unsigned graph. This is because vertices that are adjacent to a negative edge are allowed to be colored with the same integer. However, even in a sine graph, the set of vertices colored with zero must be an independent set, because since zero is its own additive inverse, we cannot color both vertices linked by a negative edge with zero, and we also cannot color both vertices linked by a positive edge with zero, because the endpoints of a positive edge must have distinct colors. One reason why the definition of sine graph colorings presented in this video is useful is because these coloring rules behave nicely under the switching operation, which is where we switch the signs of all the edges adjacent to some vertex. If we have some sine graph G sigma, and any sine graph G sigma sub 2 obtained through any applications of the switching operation to G sigma, then G sigma and G sigma sub 2 have the same chromatic number. At first, it seems like this might not be true, because suppose we had a vertex like this, where it was linked to another vertex with a negative edge, and we switched the vertex circled in red, meaning that this edge now becomes positive. Then if they were originally labeled with the same integer, our coloring would no longer be valid in the new graph. However, if we had also switched the sign of the color applied to the switched vertex, we would obtain a proper coloring again. Similarly, if we had a vertex adjacent to another vertex with a positive edge in a K-colored sine graph, and we switched this vertex, then if they were originally labeled with additive inverses in our K-coloring, that K-coloring would no longer be proper in our new sine graph. However, if we just negate the color on the vertex we switched, we once again obtain a proper K-coloring. Note that negating does not introduce any new colors that we were not already allowed to use under the rules of a K-coloring, because for every color N used in a K-coloring, the set of colors we're allowed to choose from also includes negative N. What this shows us is that regardless of what problem is introduced by switching, whether it's a negative edge connecting two vertices with additive inverse colors, or a positive edge connecting two vertices with the same color, the solution is simply to negate the color on the vertex we switched, allowing us to maintain a proper K coloring in our new switched graph. And if we do this every time we switch a vertex, we continue to maintain a proper K coloring of each switched graph, meaning that if we have a graph that is K-colorable, then all graphs switching isomorphic to that graph are also K-colorable. Basically, if G sigma and G sigma sub 2 are two switching isomorphic graphs, and G sigma is K-colorable, then each time we switch a vertex toward our goal of obtaining G sigma sub 2, we must also flip the sign of the label we gave that vertex in the original K-coloring of G-sigma. The resulting coloring we get of G-sigma sub 2 will always be a proper K-coloring. That's it for this video. In future videos, we'll look at some new graph operations, as well as explore sine graph colorings in greater depth. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe, like, share, and comment if you liked the video. Have a great day.